Good evening and welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of July 9th, 2015. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight and I will be presiding. As per our usual custom, we're going to start off with public comment. As I call your name, if you're signed up, please step up to the microphone, state your name and your address. We ask you to keep your remarks under 3 minutes and civil, basically. You should also know that the councilors are not, this is the public's turn to speak, so for once the councilors have to sit on their hands and not say a darn thing. So if that's why we asked you to be civil, because there's nothing we could say back to. So with those caveats in place, we'll start off with Matt Lemper.
Good evening. Matt Lemberg, President, International Association of Firefighters, Local 108. Thank you for allowing me to speak tonight, counselors. It's nice to be here for a couple positive reasons. So I'm here representing the IFF, Local 108, and its 61 members to endorse the appointment of Assistant Chief Dwayne Nichols to the position of Fire Chief. Assistant Chief Nichols is the right individual for the job. As our second in command, he has been responsible for the day-to-day operations of Northampton Fire Department for some time. Chief Nichols is, at all times, fair and honest. There's no question of where you may stand with him. Communication has always been upfront, and he's always available should anyone, from the newest recruit to the most senior captain, have a question. I've worked with Chief Nichols on fire investigations, the SAFE program for children, and on numerous fire scenes, and have never once doubted or questioned his leadership ability. Interactions with the administration and my local have not always been positive, but Chief Nichols was always the voice of reason between the two parties. Members of our local, as well as my leadership team, look forward to working with Chief Nichols in the future to make this department even better than it is right now. I understand that this appointment must first go to committee and then back to this body for acceptance. I strongly urge you, however, when it is time, to confirm the appointment of Dwayne Nichols as the next fire chief for the City of Northampton Fire Department. Also, as an aside, I'd like to recognize my brother, Captain Tom Clark, who retired today. His last shift, he retires officially July 11th, but 30 years on the job, done a lot of good for this city. So thank you very much.
Thank you for both those comments. Sure, sweet. Here, hang on a sec. We're going to have to adjust the microphone for you. The mayor's got you here. She's going to fix it. There you go.
My name is Shira. I live on Lincoln Ave. There are a lot of kids on my street, and the cars go very fast. The speed limit is 30 miles per hour. That is too fast for the cars to drive on our street. I think the cars should drive 20 miles per hour. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. Next up, Carl Nair. I'm sorry if I brutalized your last name. It's
used to it after. Carl Kinnear, 47 Lincoln Avenue, and sort of hard to follow up the performance by Shira there, but as Shira mentioned, we have an issue with traffic on Lincoln Avenue. Twofold. One, we are often the cut through for large semi trucks driving through Lincoln Avenue, heading to Coca-Cola plant, ignoring all the signs posted contrary, where they should be going to Damon and into the Industrial Avenue. Instead, they come down our residential street. We're in six houses. We have 20 children, the oldest in grade school, and the youngest, my three-month-old daughter. We are very concerned that between the trucks, not only are they going, but they're going fast, and that we also see cars come down North Street onto Lincoln Avenue and gun it down our one-block street to see just how fast they can get up their speedometers. So we're looking for you. To be honest, we're talked out. We're exhausted. We don't know what more to do. We know that cars are coming down way too fast on our street. I've learned that our street we're actually unclear what the speed limit is. The de facto is 30 miles an hour, and yet I see King Street with a speed limit of 20 and 25. But my residential street, one block with all these children, is a 30 mile per hour speed limit. So my question to you is, what can you do to help me? We're exhausted and we're looking for your guidance and for your help for us to provide a secure and safe place for our children to grow up. Thank you.
Thank you. Joe Squires, please.
Good evening. Joe Squires, 38 Lincoln Avenue. My wife, Michelle, and I have been living on Lincoln Avenue for the past 27 years. The city of Northampton granted Coca-Cola an industrial park and expansion several years back. The residents of Lincoln Avenue are paying the price. We have up to 20 to 25 tractor trailers a day going up and sometimes down the street. It is dirty, it is dangerous. The house shakes in the middle of the night as you try to sleep. We have lost our quality of life. Before the coke plant came to the industrial park, the city designated Lincoln Avenue as a truck detour to prevent trucks from getting stuck under the truck eating bridge. These trucks are using our street as a main route to the coke plant. Within the past 5 years, up to 6 young families have moved on to Lincoln Avenue, all with very young kids under the age of 10. These kids now call Lincoln Avenue their home. Hats off to these young parents as they have these kids outside playing 7 days a week in all kinds of weather, just like we used to do when we were all young. There is an accident waiting to happen, hopefully not fatal, as they chase after a rolling ball. This past May on Mother's Day, a beautiful sunny day, we had a picnic in our yard for mothers, family, and friends. Up to 8 tractor trailers came through the street within a 3-hour period. Not a pretty sight. It felt like we were having a picnic on the breakdown lane of Interstate 91. The city of Northampton, along with Coca-Cola, who claim they want to be good neighbors, need to work on this together to put an end to the volume of trucks we face every day. I have had 2 former counselors, Andrew Plasman, Owen Freeman Daniels, our present counselor, Ryan O'Donnell, along with former council president and now mayor, David Narkowitz, at my house to try and come up with a solution to this problem, which has gone from bad to a nightmare. If we, the residents of Lincoln Avenue in the surrounding streets, call, text, or email our elected officials, please return our messages in a timely manner. We are depending on you to get this matter taken care of before an accident takes place. We need your help now more than ever. Thank you. Summer is short. Get outside and enjoy it.
Thank you very much. Valerie Gintis, please.
Hi, I'm Valerie Gintis, 59 Lincoln Avenue, and I won't ask if any of you have sped down our street, although the odds are someone in this room has. There are, as someone mentioned, 20 kids within 6 houses on our street. They play outside in a kind of old-fashioned town that doesn't exist very much in our culture, and it's a beautiful neighborhood. However, it's terrifying as a parent. Cars come whizzing down the street, trucks come down the street both directions, both the escape route and leaving the coke plant. I've had cars hit twice on the street. Most recently, my mom's car was a hit and run. We've called the police about it, but we are terrified for our kids crossing the street. I really ask, please use your power as city council. Please help us figure out how to navigate between DPW, the police, city council, whatever committees, so that we can make sure the speed limit is dropped, other traffic calming measures are made, and we can make our street safe for our very sweet kids. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Jasper Lapienski, please.
Hello, my name is Jasper Lapienski. I live at 43 West Street. I guess I want to start by saying that for over a year, between 2012 and 2013, I worked in the industrial park and I walked to work every day up and down Lincoln Avenue. I would assume the reason that it's wider than all of the other streets is because it was designed as the truck escape route. And I actually, I think that it's a good idea to make streets safer in any case, but particularly when we're talking about streets that have been made this way without, I guess, a lot of consultation with residents. There has to be another way for trucks to get there. I haven't thought this through a lot because that's not what I thought I was going to talk about, but I just wanted to say that there's no way that we're ever going to get around the fact we don't have enough money in this city to rebuild the bridge that they would otherwise get stuck under. If we could, people would complain about truck traffic on Main Street, although obviously that in an ideal world we could do that and then take the cars off of Main Street, which has been proven in many cities around the world to dramatically increase the amount of business that can be done. the idea that every truck driver in America is smart at all is hysterical, but especially that they're smart enough to all know exactly how to get to a place that they either have been or haven't been. I can recall several times when I was walking to work and I had to give a truck driver directions, even though I'm sure they have things like Google Maps, or whatever they call it when you use Apple. I would discourage any sort of rash decision making on this that could screw up the streets for a number of other people. For instance, I had a neighbor back when I lived in Ward 3 who every couple of days had to come out of his house and watch the tractor trailer trucks who had not gotten to Lincoln Ave come down Phillips Street and then get stuck because there's a pole of National Grid where they couldn't actually make a left turn. I saw a cop once come out and over the course of 20 minutes walk a truck driver inch by inch through how to get the thing around, even though all the parked cars had obeyed the no parking past here, et cetera. So I think there probably is a solution, but it's not just going to be as simple as lowering a speed limit or taking the trucks off of one particular street. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Roy C. Martin, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen of the City Council, ladies and gentlemen of the audience, and people at home. My name is Roy C. Martin. I live at 81 Conn Street, Northampton, Massachusetts, 01060. Now, I came here tonight for the fire chief, and I find out that it's got to go through a process. So, I haven't got my three-piece suit on. I got my vest on instead. Now, when they're talking about the street, now if that street was made a one-way street, then that might alleviate a lot of that traffic because I think the trucks go up the street, and if it was made one-way coming down, then possibly a lot of that traffic would be alleviated. Now, that's one way to do it. The other way is to make it a dead-end street. You make it a dead-end street, and then no trucks are going to go up it because it's a dead-end street. But then, where are you going to send the trucks to? How are they going to get by? Now, if all the trucks wanted to go through the Coca-Cola plant, they can go straight across and up through Damon Road. Now, that's usually where most of the trucks go that I know of. Yeah, but there's a lot of traffic on Damon Road, and a lot of times the traffic gets way backed up. So the truck drivers, a lot of them know that it's easier to go down and take one of them side streets. I don't think it was a good idea at all to use any of them side streets. But right now we got a lot of work going on there and roundabouts and everything going on. And I don't know what's going to happen, but I do think that if you make it a one-way street, but of course that goes through ordinance, all of that stuff. Then that would alleviate a lot of that traffic. And then, if that don't help, make it a dead-end street. Because I know there's two or three streets right along there that's dead-end streets. Nothing goes up the street. If a truck's trailing up the dead-end street, they get stuck on the end because there's no roundabout on the end of that street. I've seen a lot of this traffic. Now, I stop every time I come and there's a bicycle going across, someone going across with a bicycle, or there was a bunch of kids going across Look Park today and I stopped. And the people behind me, they didn't stop. They tooted their horn, They wanted me to go. And here's probably 40 kids in that bunch. They must have come from the school going down to the park, going down to Look Park. And I wasn't going to go until them kids was all across the street. I can't see why. A lot of people look at me and say, how come you're going so slow? Well, I'm going slow because there's kids around me, There's people around me. So, and yes, sometimes I go a little fast and, I don't obey the speed limit a lot of times, but I try, And for tonight, that's all I got to say. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, City Council, ladies and gentlemen in the audience, and ladies and gentlemen at home. Have a good day.
Thank you. is it Michael Sparks?
Spinks.
Michael Spinks, sorry.
Spinks?
I live in 44 Lincoln Avenue. Everyone raise your hand from Lincoln Avenue.
We have a lot more people. We have 24 kids on the street. I've been with the mayor to the Coca-Cola plant. I've written a letter to the sergeant, which is now the lieutenant, never answered my calls. I met with previous city council. Not much is done. And living over here the past 8 years, traffic has gotten completely out of hand there. Truck traffic will actually shake your house, regardless how far it is set back or how new it is. There are so many families there that have, and kids that play in the street, like across the street, that if a truck was going down the street, there's no way they could stop, even if someone stepped in front of them. There is new traffic design and calming principles that really need to be addressed in our area. There have been, we've gone to the news, we've gone to the Gazette, we've been on the front page twice, nothing's happened. We need some changes. Speed limit changes would definitely be helpful. We are in between two school zones that are 20 miles per hour. For some reason, ours is 30. There's an extremely wide opening to the streets that is antiquated. For calming traffic, they should be narrowed. There should be a crossing zone in the middle. There's 24 kids on the street. And there's no way that the kids can go across the street by themselves. We need some help. We need funding. We need direction, and we need leadership, because it's getting unsafe. And as Joe said, the quality of life it's just not there anymore. We have trouble sleeping. It wakes you up. We can't make sure the kids go out of the school yard. We can't make sure they go out of our own yard. I had a party also. There was 3 tractor trailer trucks that went down in 3 hours. We've met with the police that's come to our house recently this week. That's the only reason why you see a radar gun on our street. But it's temporary. We've tried to find ways to get funding, our own funding. We'd even chip in ourselves. It's just not possible. We're told it's not legal unless it goes through certain, through city council. It's way out of hand. I had a colleague who died crossing the street in Northampton. Now there's a sidewalk. There was two people that were hit on Route 9. Now there's a sidewalk. Does my child have to be hit in order there to be a sidewalk there? Thanks.
Thank you very much. That's actually all we have signed up. Is anyone else interested in speaking at this time? No? That's sort of like speaking. Yeah, that's. I'm going to ask the secretary to call the roll, please.
Here.
Present.
Here. Here.
Here.
Here.
Here.
We have a quorum. Councilor LaBarge is absent with excuse. So we will start our business here. First up, we have right out of the gate, the communications from the mayor.
Good evening, councilors. I have several items tonight in communications from the mayor. First, I wanted to begin with a special proclamation. And we're honored to be joined by several members of the Disability Commission this evening. I see Ruth McGrath and James Winston and Tori Eklund, the chair, is here. And I did want to acknowledge your colleague, Councillor LaBarge, who also serves as your liaison on that committee. And she actually was in communication with my office about this special proclamation. So I want to thank her in absentia. And this proclamation is entitled the Americans with Disabilities Act 25th Anniversary Day, July 26, 2015. Whereas the Americans with Disabilities Act, or ADA, was passed on July 26, 1990, to ensure the civil rights of citizens with disabilities and establish legislation with clear and comprehensive national mandates for the elimination of discrimination against individuals with disabilities. And whereas the ADA has expanded opportunities for Americans with disabilities by reducing barriers, changing perceptions, and increasing full participation in community life. And whereas the City of Northampton, Massachusetts affirms the principles of equality and inclusion for persons with disabilities as set forth by the Americans with Disabilities Act, the laws of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and the ordinances of the City of Northampton. And whereas the full promise of the ADA will only be reached if our community reaffirms the principles of equality and inclusion, recommitting our efforts to reach full ADA compliance. And so, now therefore I, Mayor David J. Narkowitz, do hereby proclaim July 26, 2015 as Americans with Disabilities Act 25th Anniversary Day in the City of Northampton. And I ask the citizens of Northampton to commit to the promise of hope and freedom that is envisioned by the passage of the ADA. In witness whereof I have set my hand and imprinted the seal of the City of Northampton on this ninth day of July 2015. And I would invite the chair and any other members of the Disability Commission who wanted to come up to the podium so I can present this. So here's the proclamation. And if you want to just step a little bit more forward and,
yeah.
And you can just speak straight ahead.
Okay. Thank you very much for this special commemoration of such an important event in the disability rights movement. And this will definitely inspire us to continue to do the work that we're doing. Thank you.
Okay. You stand right there.
Sure.
You guys get in here.
Okay.
I'll hold this up. Just to let you know, Council of Arts, that this actually
yes.
happened.
Yes. This is the official vote.
Thank you all again.
Thank you.
Your Honor, I know that's not all your business.
Yes, I do have a couple of other communications I wanted to make tonight. The second one is an announcement. It's actually a meeting announcement that I wanted to make sure that both counselors and members of the public know about. It involves next Wednesday, July 15th, 2015, and it's at 5:30 p.m. Both the Public Works Commission, together with the Department of Public Works, will be having a public meeting at the JFK Community Room at JFK Middle School on 100 Bridge Street. And it's to have Tata and Howard, which is one of our city's consultants, present and discuss the Water Supply System Asset Management Plan. The purpose of this plan and the study that underlied it was to identify areas of our water supply system in need of rehabilitation, repair, or replacement, and to help prioritize improvements to make the most efficient use of the city's capital budget. The study evaluates our existing water infrastructure, including water transmission and distribution piping, and in addition, water storage needs were evaluated and prioritized. The important planning documents will be used by the DPW to help prioritize future water system improvement projects. And obviously for the council's interest, it will also inform the work that we do around setting our water rates in the future to be able to fund those capital projects. NCTV will be there. They will tape this meeting for those who can't attend, and it'll be aired at a later date. So I just wanted to encourage folks, we do have information about this meeting on the homepage of the city website. So if folks want to share that with constituents, they can do that. The only other announcement or communication that I wanted to make tonight concerns an administrative order that I have submitted to you. And I have believe it was included in time to get into your packet. It includes a memorandum as well as the actual order itself. And again, pursuant to my authority under Article 6, Section 6-1 of the City Charter, I am respectfully submitting the administrative order to consolidate the Office of the Treasurer and the Office of the Collector into one combined agency, the Office of the Treasurer-Collector. Both of these agencies perform important and parallel functions as part of the City of Northampton's Administration and Finance Division, as currently outlined in our administrative code. I believe that combining these two positions and their respective departments will create a more efficient, streamlined organizational structure for our financial team. I believe the consolidation of these agencies is in the best interest of the City of Northampton, both from an organizational and financial management perspective, and I respectfully request the City's Council's approval of my administrative order. And again, I know you will be scheduling a public hearing later tonight for August, and I stand ready to answer any questions that you have either at that hearing or in the interim about this administrative order.
Thank you very much. Thanks. We have some public hearing announcements, not the least of which was the one that was the mayor just alluded to. This is first coming up. There's the public hearing will be held August 13th, 2015 at 7:05 p.m. here in council chambers regarding the mayor's proposal to for consolidation plan to combine the Office of the Treasurer and the Office of the Collector. Also, there is a hearing regarding a poll petition from National Grid, and this will be held also on August 13th at 7:10 p.m. Now, for folks who are watching at home, none of these hearings take 5 minutes apiece, but the fact is that we schedule them at their earliest point so that whenever they occur, at least they're not premature. So this is this will also be held in council chambers, and this is relative to a proposed poll location at 206 North Main Street in Florence, and also a proposed poll location at Florence Athletic Fields. Recommendations from the DPW will be available prior to the public hearing and will be published on the next City Council agenda. Also, a public hearing regarding the certificate of registration from Chemiplastica. This is in accordance with the Mass General Law, Chapter 148, Section 13. It's a certificate of registration. A public hearing will be held on July 20th. We will be having a special meeting at that time, which we'll also be announcing soon. But that'll be at 7:15 p.m. here in Council Chambers. And that's regarding Chemiplast's incorporated petition for fuel storage. That's it for public hearing announcements.
Just a question.
Yes.
So the 13th is that a special council meeting?
That's or just a public. The 13th is actually a regularly scheduled council.
It's in August.
That's the regularly scheduled one for August meeting. Though the special meeting, which we will announce in a moment, will be occurring on the 20th, and we've tagged this on to it. There's a timeline issue, so it seemed we might as well avail ourselves of our assembly. So. The council has no proclamations, resolutions, recognitions, but we do possibly have 1 minute announcements. Councilor Adams.
On Wednesday, July 15th, from 6:30 to 8 p.m. at the Northampton Senior Center, there will be an event for LGBT elders, and people are invited to come and share in the planning of programming for LGBT elders in the area, and have an opportunity to meet other LGBT members in the community, and some refreshments will be served, and the purpose is to get some ideas and some community conversation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other 1 minute announcements? None. Okay. There are no presentations. I know this is kind of a blow, and hoping for a good summer PowerPoint presentation, but no pending licenses and petitions. So I'll accept a motion for the approval of the minutes from the last meeting.
So moved. Second.
Any discussion on the minutes? There is an amendment that the secretary would like to point out. There was a bit of an addition problem. She subtracted 2 from 9 and came up with 8. That was relative to which line item on the minutes? Do you remember? She's not talking to me anymore. The top. So to amend it to reflect the fact that actually when you subtract 2 from 9, you were back at 7. Is everyone okay with that? So Okay, so now that that's a Scrivener's error, so I will accept a vote on the minutes as amended. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. There any reports from any committees? No? Come. Oh, okay. Next up, we have the appointment of the fire chief, Assistant Chief Dwayne Nichols, and this is to refer to the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances. This is the mayor's recommendation. You also, I think you're all pretty much aware of that, and that and we've heard from the rank and file. I'll accept a motion for referral. Okay.
Second.
Any discussion on the referral? All right. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? Now, it's probably appropriate at this point to announce the fact that in consultation with the director, the chair of finance, the chair of ordinance, got to get those committees right, that referral will go to ordinance on the 20th, whereupon, this is very similar to what we did with the police chief, we will convene a special meeting. Now, for the folks at home, normally the council only meets once in July. We will have the special meeting as, and of course, as one other additional agenda item, or a public hearing. But so, on July 20th, here in council chambers, we'll convene a special meeting to accept the recommendations and vote either to approve or not the mayor's nomination of Dwayne Nichols. So, put that on your calendars. Next up, we have the reappointment of Jeffrey Jones to the Northampton Housing Authority. This appointment was approved by the City Council on April 16, 2015. However, the term was incorrect. This is a request to amend the appointment term from March 2015 to June 2020. It was originally approved through to June 2018. Mm-hmm. Councilor Murphy.
So I would move that we amend the term of Jeffrey Jones's appointment to the Housing Authority from March 2015 expiration to June 2020.
Second.
Any discussion on that? What happened was essentially the term came before us and as a three-year term, in point of fact, it is a five-year term, which is standard, as Councilor Carney can attest. Any other discussion on that? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that has been amended. The term for Jeffrey Jones has been amended to expire in 2020 as opposed to 2018. We have minutes from the committees on rules, orders, appointments, and ordinances, also Public Works, Finance Committee, and Public Safety. And those are from June 15th. For ordinance, April 9th, 2015 for Public Works, June 4th for the Finance Committee, and Public Safety of June 1st.
Move approval as a group.
Second.
Motion's been made as to move as a group and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay. Now we're going to recess for finance. And I cede the gavel over to Councilor Murphy. We go into recess.
Pam, would you read the roll of finance, please?
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
What you want? The top sheet?
Then you want my agenda? Gotta give it back.
Sorry.
No, that's it.
Councilor Adams.
Here.
Councilor Shara.
Here.
And we have minutes to approve in finance. Do we have a motion for our minutes?
Move to approve.
Second.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Great. Right. A number of financial orders, some of which finished the cleanup of the last fiscal year. The first one is upon the recommendation of the mayor, ordered that the following capital projects be appropriated from the general FY16 cash capital account. These are all things that we saw as the capital portion of the budget we approved last month, and this is simply the funding of those things. So this isn't the first time they've come by us. Central Services, a mail courier vehicle that is fuel efficient, $20,000. The building inspections, electrical and plumbing inspectors, also a fuel efficient vehicle for $28,000. Northampton Public Schools, the Leeds and Ryan Road School roofs, $5,041. Northampton Public Schools, JFK, a Dectron unit for the pool, that's the thing that deals with the humidity in the pool, $25,000. Citywide Fuel Depot, engineering and design, which is at DPW, $31,959. And DPW equipment replacement, $100,000. And DPW global positioning systems upgrade for $5,000. The total of all of these is $215,000. And the mayor is prepared to answer any questions we may have in finance, or any of us may have. Any questions for the mayor? Councilor Adams?
You just describe which DPW equipment's being replaced?
Yeah, these are, it's actually a partial funding of some equipment. The enterprise funds will also contribute. And so this is for vehicles. These are for a series of different vehicles. They're all outlined in the capital program, and they're in detail in the FY16 budget as well, in the capital budget portion of that. Many of these are partial. Obviously, the roof projects, I wish that was only $5,041 to replace two school roofs, but that's sort of a partial payment. Same for the Dectron unit, that's $25,000 of cash capital that's going to be contributed to a bunch of other borrowed money and previously put aside money. Same goes for the Citywide Fueling Depot, which the other enterprise funds will contribute to the cost of, as well as the GPS upgrade. So these are all contained in the capital portion of the FY16 budget that you approved, and we were just waiting for July 1st to pass in order to be able to actually appropriate the funds and get those projects started.
Any other questions on these? Hearing none, all in, do we have a, first of all, a motion in finance?
Second.
All right. Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Great. Thank you. The next one is upon a recommendation of the mayor, order that whereas Mass General Law 40C subsection 4A allows for joint operations of public activities among government units, and whereas Mass General Law 40C section 4A requires that such intergovernmental agreements be approved in a city by the city council and the mayor, and whereas the city of Northampton provides services to and shares services with other municipalities, therefore, pursuant to Mass General Law 40C, subsection 4A, the City Council hereby authorizes the City of Northampton to enter into the following intermunicipal agreements for FY16. Contract with the Town of Williamsburg for building inspections and zoning enforcement services. The agreement to provide the Town of Williamsburg with services for a lump sum per the agreement. Contract with the Town of Williamsburg for electrical inspection services. Agreement to provide the Town of Williamsburg with services with fees for permits turned over to the City of Northampton. Contract with the Town of Amherst and East Hampton for municipal hearing officer services. Agreement to provide municipal hearing officer services pursuant to Mass General Law 148A, subsection 2, to hear complaints related to alleged violations of state building codes or state fire codes for a lump sum per agreement. Contract with the Town of Amherst, Chesterfield, Cummington, Hadley, Middlefield, Pelham, Williamsburg, Goshen, and Worthington to provide veterans services, the veterans officer. Agreement to provide these services to various communities and assessments to individual towns per the agreement. Contract with the Town of Granby and Amherst to provide sealer of weights and measures services. Agreement to provide these services to the various communities and assessments to individual towns per that agreement. Contract with the Town of Amherst to provide on-site computer system and network maintenance for the police department's computer system and the networking resources located at the police station, fire station, and public safety communications center. Contract with the Franklin County Regional Council of Governments to monitor and support the Greater Franklin County Economic Target Area. Contract with the Town of Amherst for kennel services. Town of Amherst to provide kennel space for dogs in the custody of the Northampton Animal Control Officer per that agreement. And finally, Pioneer Valley Bike Share Partnership with the cities of Holyoke, Springfield, and the Town of Amherst, UMass, and the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission for the purposes of establishing, managing, and operating a regional bike share system for the Pioneer Valley. Do we have a motion on this one?
So moved.
Second.
Second. All right. Questions for the mayor on any of these municipal agreements?
The first seven are actually all renewals. They're renewals of long-standing existing municipal agreements. The last two are new ones that you haven't seen before. The contract with the town of Amherst, you may recall from the budget hearings with the police department, upon the retirement of our longtime animal control officer, Nancy Graham, after 32 years, who was previously a contract employee, we made the decision to bring that employee in-house and to create an in-house animal control officer / animal inspector. So beginning on July 1st, and actually our new animal control officer just started on July 1st, Shayla Howe, we have now an in-house animal control officer. As part of that, we need to have a kennel facility for those occasions when a dog may be picked up and we cannot locate the owner and it needs to be kept overnight. The previous animal control officer had an arrangement with a kennel, I believe it was in West Hampton or Williamsburg, and so the town of Amherst has set up a kennel that they are going to be offering on sort of a regional basis. So we have signed an intermunicipal agreement with Amherst to be able to use their kennel in those cases where we do have to have a dog held for either for, you know, because we can't locate the owner or for other reasons. The second one, Northampton has been exploring for some time the concept of trying to do a bike share program. An opportunity arose to be able to look at it on a regional basis with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission sort of serving as the convener. And so the cities of Holyoke, Springfield, and Amherst, UMass, along with PVPC, have sort of come together to collaborate on trying to create a regional system, just sort of using the larger economy of scale that we have to create a system that largely has been created in bigger metropolitan areas like Boston and San Francisco, et cetera. But because of the fact that this does involve an agreement among municipalities, we are required to bring this agreement to you at this point. So that's what that's all about, and I can answer any specific questions you have about any of the other agreements that are being renewed.
Any questions for the mayor?
One quick question. East Hampton was not on that list, is that correct, on the bike share?
That's correct.
Were they invited to be part of that, since we have a trail right to East Hampton?
Yeah, they were invited.
But they chose not to.
Yeah, exactly. And Wayne's been my point person in that effort. So
thanks.
These are the communities. I think they put out a call to communities in the Valley and invited them to a meeting to talk about it. And these are the communities and organizations that came forward. We did look at some systems, and I rode a bike around the parking lot. One of the vendors. It's challenging for a city our size to be able to implement this kind of a system. Just the capital cost, et cetera. So it's a unique way to look at it by looking at a bunch of different systems in the Valley and see if we can do it collectively and collaboratively. So I'm thankful to PVPC for being willing to serve that regional role.
Thanks.
Councilor Ronaldo?
I'm just wondering when the envisioned rollout for the program is.
Wayne, do you want to give an update on those meetings?
Sure. I'll accept the motion and recognize Wayne Fiden.
Yeah.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. So we're in early stages now. We're really just doing a second year of a feasibility study. I think our assumption is capital costs of the project would have to be mostly covered by grants, and that operating costs we'd have to figure out ways to cover it. And we've applied for what's called congestion mitigation air quality funding for it. So it's really, if we get that grant, whenever it comes through, we're programmed right now, or we're aiming for fiscal year 2018, but it could be longer, it could be shorter, we don't really know.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions on any of these? Councilor Klein.
I'm wondering about the is this a cost savings for us from the situation that we had previous to this?
The kenneling is separate from the other, the contract that was that existed previously was with the ACO. It was a separate contract between that person and another person who operated the kennel. So we were not directly involved in that prior kenneling arrangement. But it's a very reasonable agreement. It's basically $1,400 a year to have access to the kennel. So it's a very reasonable arrangement. If and when dogs have to be kenneled overnight, the fees are actually charged to the owner of the animal. Much like when your car gets towed and you have to come pick up your car, you have to pay the charges for garaging, et cetera. So the same would apply. So that's kind of the model. And it's actually becoming more and more common. I know that the city of Agawam has established a regional kennel that serves Agawam, Southwick, Westfield, and a number of other communities. Just, you know, there's not, it's not, just from an economy of scale, it's easier. And I believe this one's located near the UMass campus. And so they have a good sized facility. It's going to be, you know, staffed 24 hours. And so it'll be a good way for us to do it. We may look at down the road as we develop our in-house program, whether there's any value in trying to develop our own. But for now, this is a good way to transition to this new program. Overall, there'll be some savings transitioning to this new in-house model in the first year, and I think those savings will increase over time.
Any other questions on any of these? Okay, hearing none. All in favor of a positive recommendation from Finance, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Great. The next one is also upon the recommendation of the mayor. Order that the amount of $79,959 be transferred from the FY15 unused earned sick leave account to the compensated absences reserve fund for the future payment of accrued liabilities for compensated absences due any employee or full-time officer of the city upon termination of the employee's or full-time officer's employment. And I think the mayor can comp. This is basically moving stuff from one account to another.
Yeah, a couple of years ago, I think it was three fiscal years ago, we established this compensated absences reserve fund, which is sort of akin to a stabilization fund. And it's actually a recommended best practice by the Department of Revenue. And so when employees leave our service, there's often some form of a liability, whether it's a comp time balance, whether it's a sick time balance that due to whatever contractual obligation, we have a payout at that point. We do budget a small amount every year in anticipation of those kinds of payouts. But what this does, and we've been doing this now for the past couple of years, slowly putting excess money that doesn't get used up into this fund, so that it builds up for the purpose, it's only for the purpose of paying out these compensated absence reserve fund. And so the goal is, I think we have a unused balance right now about 79,000. So we'll be moving that over into this reserve account. And so that will slowly build up over time. The reason it's a best practice is because from an accounting perspective, that's sort of it's viewed as a liability. When people have, you know, when there are employees, longtime employees that have accrued a lot of sick time, that's considered a financial liability that you're gonna have to pay out someday, just like retirement is, just like retiree healthcare is. And so the concept is when the accountants and when ultimately the bond rating agencies look at our books, they see, okay, well, they've got this liability, is it funded or is it unfunded? And so by having this reserve fund established, that's a way to show that we are being fiscally responsible and putting some funds away. This would bring the balance of that account to $161,000. But when you have longtime employees retire or people that have accrued a lot of these kinds of balances, there can be significant payouts that occur. So
before we discuss it, we never got a motion on this one.
Motion to send it forward.
Second.
Full council.
Okay. Any questions for the mayor on this one? Just basically moving the money into a different named account. All right. All in favor of positive recommendation, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay. Next, budgetary transfers. On the recommendation of the mayor, order that the following FY 2015 budgetary transfers be and hereby are made to tidy up some things. Human resources, personal salaries, $423. Central services permanent salaries, $1,940. Legal services, $30,449. Central services streetlight account, $16,047. Central services electricity, $18,850. Forbes Library for R&M on buildings, $19,804. And that money is coming from these sources. Veterans services for veterans benefits, $42,409. Medical insurance, $9,250. And interest on debts, $35,854. So the total amount being transferred is $87,513. Do we have a motion on this one?
So moved.
Second. Okay. Questions for the mayor on this one?
This is basically transfer so that we can close the fiscal year 2015 with balanced budgets in these three departments, legal services, central services, and then Forbes Library. The latter two are because of unanticipated maintenance costs. In the case of central services, it's actually pretty straightforward. It's electricity, it's natural gas, it's streetlights, where those came in higher than we had anticipated. Forbes had a number of electrical and HVAC problems that occurred through the year that they had not anticipated and had not budgeted for. So this is a transfer to help cover those. And then legal services, again, this has been one of those accounts, one of our historically under-budgeted accounts that we have been over time trying to add more money to in each fiscal year to build it up to be able to meet some sort of historical averages so we don't have to do transfers. So we are having to do this transfer to true up this account. And as you'll, with this transfer, it'll bring our total spending in FY15 in the legal side to $250,449. I will note that the current budget in FY15 was $225,000, so that's why we're slightly short. We are increasing, though, the legal budget in FY16 by $25,000, bumping it up to $250,000. So all things being equal, you know, if this was happening next year, we wouldn't have to do this transfer. And then I would only point out on the legal budget side that $250,449 is actually lower than the past 3 years, in the lowest number in the past 3 years. It was last year it was $316,181 for legal. Before that, it was $277,820. So legal, like snow, is one of those unpredictable accounts. It's based on the types of claims we get. It's based on collective bargaining. It's based on just, it's multifactorial. So it's more of a challenge to budget, but we have been trying to increase our budgeted amount so we're less reliant on transfers.
Counselor. One of those other accounts is that's unpredictable and has always been wildly variable, yeah, was veteran services.
Exactly.
So you're transferring from veterans, exactly, benefits. What, and now how is that?
Because we've seen a little bit of a leveling off. I think we're starting to see a leveling off of veterans benefits. And I think part of that is we've sort of, you know, we've hit the peak in terms of, you know, we had that ramping up that happened over the last 10 to 12 years with the two wars that we were fighting. Obviously the Iraq war has now tailed off. And so I believe, you know, the last year or two, we have sort of reached kind of a plateau. So in this year, we believe that the Veteran Service will be turning back some of its benefits money. That's why we're confident in making this transfer.
It's also due, in no small part, to VSO Connor's hard work that, yeah, identifying qualified recipients and then securing the funds for them. So that's,
yep, definitely.
Okay.
Definitely. So that's why we're able to transfer some of what we think will be unexpended veterans benefits over into some of these other areas.
Any other questions for the mayor on this one? Again, this is last fiscal year, and it's money that was in the budget just being moved from one account to another to true up some accounts. All right. Then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? All right, the next one is upon the recommendation of the mayor, order that the city council approves the expenditure of $6,285 from the mayor's youth commission gift fund to pay the artist participants in the Youth Commission bench walk. Said expenditures to come from funds donated specifically for the bench walk project. Do we have a motion on this one?
So moved.
Second. Okay. Any questions for the mayor on this one?
This is just, you know, we've set up this account for the Youth Commission, and people have made donations specific to the bench walk project. And in order to be able to pay the bills and pay out, we need the council's authorization. So we've tallied up all of the various receipts and everything from that wonderful project, and it's $6,285, and we need the council's authorization to expend the monies from that gift account.
More questions? Oh, Councilor.
Just to mention a Scribner's error, there's an,
yeah, there's extra
article in there. It's City Council approve and then slash the word A or a, and just leave the expenditure of.
Thank you for.
Does somebody want to, do you want to amend that here?
Well, I'm,
you do it in council.
That's on, we'll do it in council.
Yeah.
Council.
Don't forget
that. Yeah, okay.
That was a, that was like a 3:45 on Tuesday discovery that we had to get this order in, so we were rushing.
We have a surplus of articles.
Susan was the one who talked about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Now we're going to change over and purchase some conservation land. Upon the recommendation of Mayor David J. Narkowitz and the Conservation Commission, whereas the Open Space and Recreation Plan recommends expanding open space near both the Arcadia Wildlife Sanctuary and the former Northampton State Hospital, and whereas the owners of a 17-acre parcel on East Hampton Road, map ID 4429, registry plan book 61, page 98, and book 231, page 62, have agreed to sell their property to the city for $150,000. And whereas the Conservation Commission identified this area as one of their top acquisition priorities for 2015 because of the valuable habitat link it provides between Arcadia and the former state hospital. And whereas the Massachusetts land grant provides up to 64% reimbursement for acquisition of certain conservation areas and is a reimbursement program which requires the city to demonstrate that it has all of the funds necessary to acquire the conservation properties prior to state reimbursement. Therefore, order that the Conservation Commission is authorized to purchase or otherwise acquire for conservation and passive recreation purposes as provided in Mass. General Law 40, subsection 8C, any fee, easement, or conservation restriction as defined by Mass. General Law Chapter 184, subsection 31, or any other interest in the above land and any immediately adjoining land, that the City Council hereby accept such conservation restrictions, that the Conservation Commission is authorized to grant conservation restrictions on any land so acquired, and that the Conservation Commission is authorized to contract for and expend any federal, state, or other rate available for this project, including any grants from the Division of Conservation Services of the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs under the Land Self-Help Act, Mass. General Law, Chapter 132A, subsection 11. Further, that $150,000 is appropriated for such acquisition. To meet this appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $150,100 under Mass. General Law, Chapter 44, subsection 7, and that the Conservation Commission is authorized to contract for any federal, state, or other aid available for this project, including any grant from the Division of Conservation Services of the Executive Office of Environmental Affairs under the Land Self-Help Act, Chapter 132A, subsection 11 of the General Laws. Further, that any grants, donation, or sales shall be applied to reimburse the Open Space Fund for the purchase. We got a motion on this one?
So moved.
Second. Okay.
And I will turn the podium over to Mr. Fiden, who can
who
talk
to recognized.
You through these.
Any questions for Mr. Fiden?
Is any of the property front East Hampton Road?
It does. It's a small piece of frontage.
And what's its developable, you know, possibilities?
It's very steep. So most of the property is steep and very wet glacial tills and not really developable. There's a little corner that's flat. We're doing a perk test to try to figure out that answer to see if we could carve off a building lot there. So we don't know the answer to that yet.
Cool. More questions? Councilor O'Donnell.
I don't know if this is a question for anyone in particular, but is the figure of $150,100 in the...
That's a mistake.
That's a mistake. So
that should be $150,000 even. I just want to point out one other thing. We do this every year when we apply for these grants. We are not planning to borrow a penny for this acquisition. So the way this grant program works, they really want you to show, you're required to show that you have borrowing authority. So we always do these with, basically borrow from the city's balance sheet. You know, if the grant pays for 64% of this, the city can come up with the money because we then get reimbursed within 60 days. And so we just carry it through. So every year we borrow, this time of year and every year in January, Susan comes before you and asks you to
rescind the borrowing as the project was grant funded.
Just that this seems consistent with plans we've had in the past in order to provide a corridor for wildlife that would be coming from that area, especially since we did take a portion of that stretch of Route 10 and develop it for the industrial park some time ago, and I remember there was discussion then. So, I mean, I'm heartened by the fact that we're providing at least a portion of that stretch for a wildlife corridor to Arcadia.
Further questions for Ms. Councilor?
It's a good time to be a moose in Northampton.
So you all know in terms of this business park idea, so 25 years ago when City Council passed the zoning, you or your predecessors approved a large area for a business park, but it had a 100-foot buffer, a 200-foot buffer from all wetlands. It said that most of the site couldn't be developed, and the idea was the private sector would develop the entire parcel, keep a lot of its open space, and develop the flat area. That never really happened, so we're sort of doing the same thing ourselves. Right. We're buying the land of the north, but you all, as you said, have been rezoning some of the property to the south where the development's more appropriate there.
Any more questions, Councilor Doyle?
Does that mean this land's ever been considered at any point, that corner that you talk about, that you're waiting to have it working? Has that ever been considered by anybody else to develop that property?
No. I mean, again, the rezoning happened 25 years ago, and that's one of the things that convinced us we need to get more involved, is nobody has done anything on that property. And that property could have been. They could have come forward and carved that out for development, and the numbers just weren't there. Our thinking is, if we get the state grant, we would buy the entire 17 acres of land. The state would pay 64% of it. If we didn't get the state grant, we'd still be looking at, is there a way to make the numbers work? And we'd be looking at that lot, but that lot's more likely to be a single family home. It's not big enough to be a sort of commercial development out there.
So realistically, for that business park concept to actually work, we have to put a sewer line over there, right? Because there's no sewer line over there, so there isn't going to, the private sector can't really do much of anything until there's a sewer line on the other side of the
That's
river.
That's correct. The southernmost property, the Raymond property, which you rezoned last year, is close enough to East Hampton.
That they can go that way. Yeah, because the daycare center goes that way.
That's exactly right. And then there's about 4 acres, the next property north that's owned by Alan Goldfarb, and that could be developed, and basically everything north of that probably could not be.
Any further questions on this one? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The next one, upon the recommendation of the Conservation Commission, whereas the Open Space and Recreation Plan recommends expanding open space along the historic Mill River and the Connecticut River floodplain, whereas the owners of a 3.13-acre parcel on Manhattan Road have agreed to sell their property to the city for $3,300. And whereas the Conservation Commission identified this area as a key portion of the historic Mill River Greenway, protection of rich habitat along the former Mill River, and whereas Mass Audubon Society supports this project as an important addition to their effort to protect valuable continuous floodplain forest, and has agreed to absorb all of the stewardship costs of a conservation restriction that they will hold, and whereas the funds are already available for the purchase of this property and no new appropriations are required, therefore order that the Conservation Commission is authorized to purchase or otherwise acquire for conservation and passive recreation purposes, as provided Mass General Law 40, subsection 8C, any fee, easement, or conservation restriction as defined in Mass General Law 184, subsection 31, or any other interest in the above land and any immediately adjoining land, the City Council hereby accepts such conservation restriction, that the Conservation Commission is authorized to grant conservation restrictions on any land so acquired. Further, that any grants or donations shall be used to reimburse open space fund used for the purpose, and the property is identified as map 39, lot 47. Do we have a motion on this?
So moved.
Second. All right. Mr. Feiden, any questions for Mr. Feiden on this one? And this is pretty remote.
It's pretty remote, although it's right next to the interstate, so it's very...
Access
is very remote.
Unless you jump off the highway.
Right. Yeah. So very small parcel of land, but it's part of an overall story. We've been working with Mass Audubon and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service about protecting the historic Mill River. Fish and Wildlife Service has purchased most of the land on the current, the Mill River that still has water. This section of the Mill River has been dry since 1750, but it's very rich in vernal pools. We've been buying land and also closing the road. We've had a problem in these roads with people dumping trash. So we bought some land close to Pleasant Street, which you all approved last year, and we closed Dyke Road, opened for pedestrians, but closed for vehicles. This is the next section. Once we acquire this and one other parcel, we hope to close this as well. Vehicles still open for foot traffic.
And this is separated from the Oxbow by the highway itself, right?
That's
the
right.
Highway goes between this and the road. Any other questions for Mr. Feiden on this one? No? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And another conservation one. Upon the recommendation of the Conservation Commission, whereas the Open Space and Recreation Plan recommends preserving privately owned farmland with agricultural preservation restrictions to permanently preserve farmland and provide food security, and whereas the owners of 0.85 acres on Island Road have agreed to sell an architectural preservation restriction, preservation restriction, on their property for $1,000, and whereas the Conservation Commission and Agricultural Commission support a local agricultural preservation restriction program for property owners who want to participate and preserve farmland, and whereas funds are already available for the purchase of this property and no new appropriations are required, therefore order that the Conservation Commission is authorized to purchase or otherwise acquire an agricultural preservation restriction defined in Mass General Law 184, subsection 31, in the above land and any immediately adjoining land, and that the City Council hereby accepts such restriction. Further, that any grants or donations shall be used to reimburse the open space funds used for the purchase, and it's identified as map 46, lot 25. And good luck finding this one. Mr. Feiden.
So as a matter of policy, we either buy conservation land or work with state and federal partners for preserving the land. For farmland, we generally don't want to own the property because that gets too complicated for us to own the property and lease it out, and we only buy farmland. It's a few rare exceptions. So our preferred method of preserving farmland, and this is basically wherever we can find farmland in the city, is when a farmer wants to put a permanent restriction on the property, we would like to buy that restriction. So the land remains in private hands, and basically our policy is we don't want to lose any existing farmland. This is a very small piece. This is the smallest agricultural restriction we've ever done, but it's part of this vision of taking these properties as we can get them. Last year, with your approval, we bought APRs on 80 acres of land in the meadows. This year, less than one so far, but it's sort of part of it overall.
Do we get a motion on this one, by the way? Can we get a motion on this one?
Second.
Second. Okay. Councilor DeWitt?
This is currently being farmed now?
It is.
It's not fallow, so?
Correct.
Okay.
All right, Councilor Rodell.
I'm just curious. It's an APR on this land, and it also says on immediately adjoining land. Does that mean if there's a parcel that becomes available that this authorizes us to put the same thing?
You know, we put that language in all the time because surveys are inaccurate, and sometimes we discover the same person owns more land.
Okay.
If a different property came up under a different owner, we have always come back to you. I guess we could ask legal counsel that we need to, but we've always come back. Okay. It's really been more if we find out that person owns a little more.
1 foot here, 1 foot there.
Any more questions for Mr. Feiden? Okay, hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you. Upon the recommendation of the Conservation Commission, Order that whereas the Open Space Recreation and Multi-Use Plan recommends preserving Meadows farmland, and whereas on December 18, 2014, the City Council authorized the purchase of land and agricultural preservation restrictions on 7 acres of farmland owned by Peter Bay on the south side of Hunts Road between Kings Highway and Walnut Tree Road, which is map ID 40, lot number 1, which will help allow the land to remain in active agricultural production. Whereas the city has determined that the best way to structure the transaction is for the city to purchase an agricultural preservation restriction on the property for up to $9,000, and for the Kestrel Land Trust to purchase the fee interest in the land. Whereas funds will be drawn from the CPC conservation funds, grants, and community donations, and no additional appropriation is required for this purpose. Now, therefore, be ordered that the city, through its Conservation Commission, is authorized to acquire an agricultural preservation restriction as defined in Mass General Law 184, Section 31, and that said restriction is hereby accepted if the Kestrel Land Trust trades the land they so acquire for land which provides public access to Rainbow Beach for or for an agricultural preservation or conservation restriction on other meadows land, then the Conservation Commission is further authorized to purchase said interests in the land. We have a motion on this one?
So moved.
Second. And Mr. Biden.
So this one's a little complicated. If you remember, you approved this last December. You allowed us to buy this property to first choice was used as trade land to get access to Rainbow Beach. Second choice was to get access for other farmland, and third choice was just to protect it by itself. Legal counsel thinks that us buying land and trading it out is problematic for a number of reasons. So this is basically the same deal, crafted in a different way. The city would buy an agriculture preservation restriction on the property, which is perfectly legal. Kestrel Land Trust, who's a partner with us in many deals, would buy the land, and they would work with us to try to do the same swap eventually for the property. So the outcome's the same, the mechanism's the same.
They just hold it rather than we have. Questions on this one? Council?
We talked earlier in the day about it, but is Kestrel in any way encouraged through the language of the agreement to seek that trade, or they're just empowered to do it?
Under the language, because they'd be buying the land directly, so we don't have legal leverage. But Kestrel's been a wonderful partner in a lot of deals, and so they're coming with their eyes open. They're coming. We specifically invited them to achieve this goal, and they're happy to achieve the goal. So that's why they're here.
Any further questions on this one?
So this would be one in a series of purchases that may need to be that may need to happen in order to ultimately provide some sort of public access?
That's correct. Okay. And the unknown, going back to Councilor Downell's question, Kestrel is not a long-term holder of land. So they're going to do best due diligence to acquire land and trade. There are only 3 or 4 parcels that would serve that function. Mm-hmm. And there's absolutely no guarantee that any of those property owners want to do the trade. So it may or may not achieve the purpose, but at least we're going to try.
Other questions? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, say aye.
Aye.
Upon the recommendation of the Office of Planning and Sustainability, order that whereas both the Sustainable Northampton Comprehensive Plan and the Northampton Housing Needs Assessment and Strategic Housing Plan recommend the creation of more affordable housing to meet the mix of community needs, and whereas on November 7th, 2013 and June 5th, 2014, City Council approved funding for the Grantham Group's Christopher Heights Assisted Living Residence at Village Hill, with over half the units being dedicated as affordable units subject to the recording of an affordable housing restriction pursuant to the Community Preservation Act, Mass General Law 44B. Whereas on October 11, 2012, the Planning Board issued plan approval to the Grantham Group for the Christopher Heights Assisted Living Residence in Village Hills subject to the recording of an affordable housing restriction pursuant to Northampton Zoning and the Smart Growth Zoning Overlay District, Mass General Law 40R. And whereas the Office of Planning and Sustainability is charged with coordinating these approvals and coordinate the affordability restrictions, now therefore it be ordered that the city acting through its mayor is authorized to accept said affordable housing restrictions on Christopher Heights. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second. Okay. Any questions on this one for Mr. Fiden or the mayor? Whoever your choice.
Is this a permanent restriction?
Yeah,
it is.
It's all we have to 80 years.
80. 80. Okay.
Usually it's 99, but well, yeah.
This is 80. Okay.
Sounds permanent to me.
Yeah, we're gonna have to worry about it again. Any other questions on this one, Councilor Adams? You have just a chuckle, no question. All right, then. All in favor of a positive recommendation in finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Right. And the last one. Upon the recommendation of the Conservation Commission, whereas the Open Space and Recreation Plan recommends preserving open space along the Connecticut River and the Connecticut River floodplain, and whereas the city owns 1.98 acres on Hockenham Road, map 39, lot 18, the city has no use, or that the city that has no city use or management. And whereas the Conservation Commission identified this area as an appropriate expansion of the nearby Silvio Oconte National Fish and Wildlife Refuge, whereas the Agricultural Commission found no agricultural value for the parcel, and whereas the Northampton DPW is not aware of any current or future needs for this parcel for public works purposes, and whereas the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service has expressed an interest in acquiring the parcel, order that the City Council finds this parcel surplus to city use and authorizes the mayor to transfer it to the United States of America for inclusion in the Conte Fish and Wildlife Refuge. Do we have a motion on this one?
So moved.
Second.
All right. Any questions for the mayor, Mr. Fiden, on this one?
I'm looking at the map itself. It's not in the same portion there of the previous property, the bay property. Is it just four lots down from that, or is it?
That's
it
right.
Is.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. That little curve that's further north.
Okay. So if that were to actually be part of the Conte Wildlife Refuge, then that would also be something that would open up some access to Rainbow Beach, possibly in the future.
It would become a public parcel. That's correct.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
And this isn't contiguous with the remainder of the Conte Wildlife.
That's area. Correct.
But it may be someday.
Right. We've worked with Conte. We've helped them put together several of the deals for land they own in town. The line that we've drawn is any place where Conte's buying land that's woods, floodplain, forest, or land that floods very frequently, more than once every 5 years, we've been working with them. Where their land is productive farmland and private ownership, we discourage them from buying that property. They obviously have the right to buy it directly, but it wouldn't be through us. So we sort of, we're partners with them in many areas, but because we partner with the Ag Commission, we're following their guidance and not going after those pieces. This property is basically a site that's unfarmable. It's a huge pile of soil. We think, although we're not sure, that this actually dates back to the Hockman Ferry, that this is where they stored equipment out of the frequent floodplain when there was a ferry across the river, and that in doing that work, it became unusable for farming.
Any more questions for Mr. Fiden? Hearing none, then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, and I don't know of any new business. Does anyone in finance know of any new business? Then a motion to adjourn finance.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
All right, so we come out of recess and back into the regular meeting, and we get to revisit those financial orders in a slightly different order than you had them in finance. Starting off, I'll accept a motion for the capital projects to be appropriated from the general fund FY16 cash capital account. And there's, by the way, a note on these. There's a request for two readings, and we can ask the mayor about the urgency of that. But I'll accept a motion for support on the floor.
Second.
Okay. Your Honor, would you speak to the two readings request for all these?
Yeah, the reason we generally have this meeting or request that we hold this July meeting as close to July 15th as possible is that's the last. Even though the fiscal year closes on June 30th, we are allowed under Mass General Law to do final transfers within the FY15 budget up until July 15th. So our ability to effectuate these transfers expires on July 15th. So generally, we are scrambling right up until this meeting to try to get all of these transfers in place. So that's why we need two readings, because if you wait until August, there will be no funds left in we'll no longer have access to the FY15 budget. It closes after that point. So that's why this happens virtually every year at this meeting in July prior to the July 15th deadline.
Since it's important to note that the state has set up a situation so that we have to actually violate our rules and we have to suspend our rules so we don't violate them. They were suspended. So
I would point out they didn't pass their budget till July 8th. So obviously
they had different rules for different people.
Exactly.
So the motion's on the floor and seconded. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
That passes in first reading.
Motion to waive two readings rule.
Motions are made and seconded to suspend rules to allow for a second reading. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed?
Second reading?
Second.
Second reading is made, moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Passes in second reading. So next up, we have the financial order for compensated absence reserve fund transfer from the FY15 budget surplus, and once again, a request for two readings. I'll accept a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motions are made and seconded. Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. Passes in first reading.
Move to suspend rules.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to suspend rules. Any discussion on that? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Accept a motion for the second reading.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. So now we have financial order for budgetary transfers for FY2015. I'll accept a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Suspend rules.
Motions are made and seconded to suspend rules. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? I'll accept a motion to on the second reading.
So moved.
Second. Motions are made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Shera.
Yes. Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. It's passed. Next up, we have the financial order to approve the expenditure for the Mayor's Youth Commission gift fund to pay the artists. Is there a motion?
Move approval.
Second.
Motions are made and seconded. Any further discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Passes in first reading. I'll accept a motion to suspend rules.
Move to suspend rules.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? I'll accept a motion for the second reading.
So moved.
Second.
Motions are made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor
Shera. Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Motion passes in second reading. Now we have a purchase of 17 acres for the Rocky Hill Greenway off East Hampton Road.
So moved.
Second.
There is no request for two readings on this, and I presume that that's all okay. Okay. So in first reading, any further discussion on this item? Councilor Adams.
Friendly amendment to change this. In the second paragraph, the second amount should be $150,000 as well as the first amount.
Thank you. The scrivener's adjustment that Councilor O'Donnell originally pointed out, so the two numbers are reconciled. Is there a second on that amendment? We'll just do
second.
Okay. Any discussion further? All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay. So that as amended, any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwyer.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor Sharon.
Yes.
O'Donnell.
Oh, yes. By all means.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Passes in first reading, and we will revisit that in our next meeting in August. Next up is the purchase of 3.3 acres for the historic Mill River Greenway off Manhattan Road. Is there a motion?
Moved to approve.
Motion's been made and seconded with zeal and gusto. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sharon.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Passes in first reading. We have a financial order to purchase an agricultural preservation restriction on 0.85 acres off Island Road. I'll accept the motion.
So moved.
Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sharon.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. That passes in first reading and will be revisited at our next council meeting in August. Not the special meeting, but the next council meeting in August. We have a financial order to acquire land on Hunts Road. It's owned by Peter B. Bay.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sharon.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Passes in first reading. Now we have financial order for the intermunicipal agreements for FY 2016.
Move approval.
Motion made. Seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sharon?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Now we have a financial order to accept an affordable housing restriction at Christopher Heights. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
The last financial order is to surplus a parcel on Hockenham Road, transfer to the USA. That's this country for inclusion in the Conte Fish and Wildlife Refuge.
Approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor
yes.
Councilor
yes. Okay. Rock the finance. Thank you, Wayne. Now we come up to an ordinance, and this is to revise section 312-102 of the parking prohibited at all times, Crescent Street. This comes with a positive recommendation from the committee on rules, orders, appointments, and ordinances. I'll accept a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion, Councilor O'Donnell.
Yeah, if I may, this was approved by the Transportation and Parking Commission a year ago. And then it fell into a deep abyss and wasn't rescued until recently. So it came back, and now it's before us. What it essentially does is removes one parking space at on Crescent Street, right where it touches Round Hill Road. And the reason is because it's just very narrow at that location. And so when you kind of, when you went around that parking space, you were pretty much way in the middle of the road. So it made sense to remove it. It's 84 feet because it's, you know, 20 feet from the intersection, and then there's a fire hydrant, and then there's someone's driveway, but nonetheless, it's still just one parking space. So that's what it does.
Any questions or discussion on this? Any further? No?
Roll call on first reading.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Kearney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Kearney?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Yes.
That passes in first reading. Next up, we are in order to revise section 312-99, violations and penalties. This also comes with a positive recommendation for the committee on rules, orders, and appointments and ordinances.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion on this one? Councilor O'Donnell.
By way of explanation, basically the current ordinance mentions a penalty of $10 if you don't pay your fine, but it doesn't mention the second $10 penalty that you get if you still don't pay your fine. And so this ordinance would make us conform with reality, because there are two $10 fines, and the second $10 fine goes along with when a fine is submitted to the registry, and then they also assess a fine. I'll just note for the record that while this has been happening, a second $10 fine has been assessed. It's been done in accordance with a provision in Chapter 90 in Mass General Law, which allows us to assess fees and that kind of thing. And so that's what we've been doing. The parking enforcement officer, Nancy Forrestal, thought this would be a good idea to have the ordinance reflect that fact just for the purpose of transparency. So
this is actually a fee, not an additional fine. This is a fee is that the way we're presenting it?
It's a fine. I mean, it's a penalty. So
it's a penalty on top of a fine.
Yeah.
For non-payment. So it doesn't qualify necessarily as a fee. It's not necessarily going to offset costs involved in processing and all that. So as a fine, we're given a little more latitude than it's if it were a fee.
Yeah, I might have just to speak to that point, I might have used the wrong term, but yeah, Chapter 90, Section 20A and a half. That's one half of A. It specifically says that, you know, any city or town with a director with the authority to make these rules can set a schedule of fines for violations. So those are the terms.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Kearney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Now we have, and that passes in first reading, now we have an ordinance to establish a special committee to review city ordinances. As a first reading, it comes with a positive recommendation from the Committee on Rules, Orders, and Appointments and Ordinances as amended. I'll accept the motion, put it on the floor.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Do you want to speak to this, Councilor O'Donnell, again?
Sure, I'm happy to. Basically, there's a provision in our city charter, section 10-5, that instructs us to every 5 years, in years that end in 5 or 0, starting in 2015, to pass an ordinance to establish a special committee to conduct a review of our ordinances and possibly suggest revisions or recodification of them. And so that's This ordinance would fulfill that responsibility. And if I could just, the charter says, to be more accurate, it says the city council and mayor. So it's kind of a joint responsibility. And in talking with the mayor about it, he actually had some excellent suggestions, which I'd like to offer, if that makes sense, on his behalf as an amendment. So I would move that In order to explain the amendment, I'll essentially reread the whole thing as amended. That would be the simplest way. So I would move that this ordinance read, a special committee is established to conduct a review of some or all of the ordinances of the city. We may need to amend that further for grammatical purposes now that I'm looking at it. So let me start again. A special committee is established to conduct a review of some or all of the ordinances of the city at 5-year intervals in years ending in a 5 or in a 0 in accordance with section 10.5 of the city charter. 2, the special committee shall be comprised of 5 members. 3 members shall be members of the city council appointed by the council president. 2 members shall be voters of the city appointed by the mayor. The special committee shall be under the supervision of the city solicitor. 3, the special committee shall convene within 30 days of the appointment of the members, hold meetings as necessary, and file the following with the city clerk no later than December 31st of the year in which its review is conducted. A, a report summarizing the committee's recommendations, and B, any proposed revision or recodification of the ordinances of the city contained therein. So that's my amendment.
So I'll second that.
And the amendment seconded. Is to the point of discussion, you want to expand on it?
Yeah, I mean, basically the ordinance that was submitted, I mean, the substantive difference is basically that the mayor now can appoint 2 members to this special committee and the council president will appoint 3. Originally, we had the council president vote appointing all members, but again, it's a joint responsibility under the charter, so I think that makes sense of the mayor be involved. Other than that, the amendment just is just superior language and clarifies the reason why we're doing this. So,
For the public's consideration, the just so everyone's up to speed, that we did a major clean sweep overhaul about a year ago for orders and ordinances, and you know, we'll discuss this a little later, but it might be a little premature to set up something right now to reconsider stuff that's just been introduced in the last year. But the fact remains that the establishment, this actually codifies the process and the rules by which we would establish a committee going forward, there's the word, and defines, I think quite appropriately, the authority is who determines and how, who the committee is and how it's set up. And it didn't send me that. I was sending you the language, Pam, but the internets are not working here today. Councilor Klein.
I just, Councilor O'Donnell wanted to clarify some of the things that I didn't quite get a grip on when you were reading the amendment. So you're saying that the mayor will appoint 2 members of the community, voting citizens, and then the city council president appoints 3 members from the city council and 1 of the citizen members?
To answer your question, I think the special committee will be 5 members total. Right now, the amendment, I guess, is still, we haven't voted on the amendment, have we?
No,
we have not.
Yet.
Still
no.
Pending. Okay, as it would be amended, 3. It just says 3 members. Yes, you're correct. 3 members shall be members of the city council, and then the mayor would appoint 2 others who are voters in the city. Yeah.
Okay. And then the only other thing I wanted to ask about was in the first section. You said on years that end in 0 and 5. Is that what it is?
Correct. That's
according
from the charter.
Of section 10.5 of the city charter. Mm-hmm. So I think that maybe you want to reverse the order of the where you have the years 5 and 10 because that's in the city charter. You know what I'm saying?
Could you clarify? I'm sorry.
In accordance with section 10-5 of the city charter,
yes.
That essentially is mandating that in years that end in 0 and 5, there's just something wonky about the order there because we can figure this out later. We don't have to do it right now, but
okay.
I just am a little worried that there's some confusion with the language there.
Maybe I restate the first bullet also, because when I did originally, I said there was a grammatical problem, but it actually, if there was, it was mine. So I think I should restate it anyway so the amendment is clear. A special committee is established to conduct a review of some or all of the ordinance of the city to be conducted at five-year intervals in years ending in a 5 or in a 0, in accordance with Section 10-5 of the City Charter.
I see. In accordance with, okay.
So that clarifies the amendment as well. Thank you.
Discussion on the amendment.
I thought that's what we were just doing.
Yes. Any other further discussion?
Okay.
I'm just abbreviating everything at this point. Dropping verbs and things like that. So the all those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, now back to the original order as amended. Any further discussion?
Just that this would be a really exciting special committee for anyone who is interested. It is important.
It is, and one of the important features of the amended language is not necessarily reviewing them in their entirety. You can specifically target on any given five-year span particular areas where rules may become archaic or problematic. We do certainly find that we have particularly ordinances that are crafted based on response to technology that doesn't exist anymore. An example is once upon a time it was against the law to roll a barrel hoop down the street, on Main Street. Not really a big issue anymore, so it might not necessarily stand as a law, although it could still clearly be defined as a hazard, although I defy anyone to find a barrel hoop to do that. But the fact is that we have rules that are antiquated. Sometimes we have rules that we make that are run counter to the Constitution that might need being addressed. And so rather than we are not necessarily charged with doing a wholesale review of every ordinance and order every 5 years, because I think it'd be a short straw job if you assign that to any three counselors who would roll their eyes and cuss you to whoever the council president is to the heavens. So I think this is good and solid language in it, and it's going to make sense.
Just to reiterate what you stated earlier, in that an exhaustive review of orders and ordinances was done really by the then ordinance committee, and did eliminate many things. I don't remember the barrel, but we certainly...
It's still on the books.
We got rid of the town crier after suggesting that any one of the present councilors be appointed as town crier. We got rid of that.
We wanted to change it to town whiner. What's the new position, Councilor Klein?
How, in essence, if we're doing only some of the ordinances, how are those chosen? How does that process happen?
Well, Councilor O'Donnell, you want to speak to that?
I would just say it's at the discretion of the special committee. That'd be my opinion. But again, the city solicitor will help oversee this process, and so I think his opinion would be relevant.
I guess my only thing I would weigh on it is I think if you read the language of the charter, it's the mayor and the council. So I think we would probably charge the committee, or sort of, you know, give the committee kind of a charge, like much like you're describing.
Yeah.
So that may be one way to work it out. That's just what the language says. So we may want them to look at ordinances that are more than 10 years old, or
right.
We may want to focus on just one specific policy area or something like that.
Just to point out that the previous committee that reviewed the orders and ordinances did rely heavily on the office of the city solicitor to help guide that process, and it's relevant that this committee is actually under the supervision of the city solicitor for much of the legality.
I'd just like to note that there aren't barrel hoops, but there's plenty of hooping that goes on in Northampton.
That is true, but we have no ordinances pertaining to that. They damn well better not roll them down the streets, however, because they'll be held to pay. There's a fine of something like 65 cents or something like that. So,
I'd like to move to the other question.
Yeah.
Roll call, please.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sarah.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor
Kern. Yes.
That passes in first reading. Next, we have an ordinance pertaining spelled incorrectly, but it doesn't matter. It's just inverted. An ordinance pertaining to special conservancy district. This is the second reading. It comes with a positive recommendation from the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances, and from the Planning Board.
Move approval and second reading.
Second.
Made and seconded. Any further discussion on this item? No? Roll call, please.
Counselor Klein.
Yes.
Counselor Murphy.
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Counselor Shara.
Yes.
Counselor Adams.
Yes.
Counselor Carney.
Yes.
Counselor Dwight.
Yes. Passes in first in second reading. So, and then next we have this is an ordinance to specify parking limits on North Maple Street in Florence, and this is to refer to the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances. Motion's made. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay.
I'd just like to offer a friendly amendment to refer to transportation parking as well.
Okay. The motion to refer to transportation and ordinance, and that's okay. Any further discussion on that? All those in favor of referral, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that's done. I have no updates. And there's no information requests and no new business, so I will accept the non-debatable motion.
Second.
All those in favor of adjourning, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you all very much. Have a great remainder of your summer till July 20th when we meet and we convene here.